this location.
Okay.
Got my message? I'll just show you the cross section of fibula also. You will realize that medial tibial condyle is long in the front back direction. So femoral condyle can move front and back. The medial femoral condyle. Clear?
Thank you.
So this is the medial side pivots. Clear? Okay. So moving a little further, and I'm now also telling you how should you select your design. Like generally what happens is that you want a good degree of movement. There should be good amount of movement. So how do you decide that which design is going to give you what kind of movement? So those kind of things I'm clearing to you. So going one by one. First, how to choose your material. See, ceramics were tried, they failed. Tantalum, that porous metal was tried, and cementless fixation was tried, it failed. So these things have not been successful. So you only have the cemented versions available. Stainless steel was the first one, then titanium came up, and then cobalt chromium became the metal of choice. With titanium, you have less of stress shielding. We talked of it in the hip replacement. But problem is that there is no stress shielding in the knee. So knee has nothing like stress shielding. Here, stiffness is more important, strong component, so that wearing is not there. So cobalt chromium is a stronger material. So this is more popular in knee implants. And yes, zirconium, this has come up. It's a part of ceramics only, zirconium oxide. This is now also coming up as a good substance of xenium, zirconium. And a coating of gold is also being popularized now. So even gold implant is cobalt chromium, but it is coated with a gold layer because gold is very inert material. You don't have allergic reactions, metallosis, those kind of things in the knee. So these are more or less like cosmetic things. But cobalt chromium is like the basic material you can find in most cases. The spacer that you are going to use, choose a 6th generation spacer. With knee implant cap in India, you have all the choices now in front of you. What is meant by a 6th generation poly? Yeah, a highly crossed linked, ultra high molecular weight polyethylene. So first you had polyethylene, then you had highly crossed linked polyethylene, then you had ultra high molecular weight polyethylene, 3 generations. Then you had vitamin E soakage, one more generation added to quench the free radicals. Then you have this annealing remelting process. Done under vacuum, it is melted and frozen, and then it's sterilized by gamma radiation. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6th generation poly. That is what you should preferably choose. That is the longest half-life. My question in FNB exam was this: generations of polyethylene. Okay. The cement type you can choose is simplex or pelagos. Many people ask me, sir, what is pelagos? So basically, normally that white cement you use, that is simplex. The green cement you use is pelagos. Company says that pelagos has faster setting time. So you can speed up the knee replacement surgery, which many surgeons need. The differentiation of green cement from the tissues is easier. That is another thing the company says. And then they also say that the durability of pelagos is more than simplex. They are only company claims. So choose the cement as what suits you. Early stages, choose simplex. You need the setting time because you are not as quick as that. Okay. And yes, both of them can be antibiotic impregnated. You can have antibiotics mixed in the cement. Don't choose antibiotic cement. The life of the cement goes down when you add antibiotics. Clear? Now choosing your femoral component. Two types of femoral components are there in the market. Like if you take the Scorpio design by Stryker, you find the single axis design. If you go by Zimmer, they have the multiple axis design. So what is basically single axis, multiple axis? Let me explain to you. Yeah, both PMMA, Kishore, both cements are same, polymethyl methacrylate. Okay. So this posterior condyle, okay, if you go by the single axis design, it has a same radius of curvature anywhere, this posterior femoral condyle. This is single axis. Now the concept of multiple axis says that the center of rotation of knee is not fixed. It translates through a J-shaped curve. So this radius of curvature is less posteriorly. It is high in front. So the condyle is not shaped like a ball naturally. So multiple axis design says that you have variable number of radius of curvature as you go posteriorly. Like this radius of curvature is higher, this radius of curvature is lesser. The proponents of multiple axis design say that this increases the this decreases the posterior condylar offset, because when the posterior radius of curvature will decrease, the posterior condylar offset will decrease. The proponents of single radius of curvature design say that when you have the same radius of curvature, this posterior condylar offset is very high. So very simple, when you have a high posterior condylar offset, you're supposed to gain more of flexion. But when you're not going to have high radius of curvature, the offset will be less posteriorly. The flexion will be not high. So that is how the two curvatures came up. Now, very simple. People who had this decreasing radius of curvature posteriorly, they say that when the posterior offset is less, you flex the knee, the tension on the collaterals is less. So eventually you achieve good amount of flexion. So at the end, what was realized? That you choose any dam design, the end result is you practically achieve same flexion. So what is the contribution of the posterior condylar offset is very debatable. But yes, you should try to have a good, reasonably good amount of posterior condylar offset so that there is no impingement. But you can choose between either of the two designs because it is still not clear in the literature that which is the more beneficial design. But I've told you the technical funda that when there's a single radius of curvature, means same radius of curvature, you will have a high condylar offset posteriorly. But if there's a decreasing radius of curvature, like this radius of curvature is high, but this is less, the condylar offset will decrease. But the tension on the collaterals will also decrease in flexion. So you might be able to give even more of movement. Okay. So at the end, this is surgeon's choice. In the femoral component, something very important for movement. The patella has to sit in the trochlear groove. So the depth of the trochlear groove has to be high. So you have to cut more amount of bone. So the implants, where the notch cut will not remove much of bone, they won't be able to give you a good amount of flexion. Because patella won't be able to engage the trochlear sulcus. It might dislocate. So this cut will be higher, the higher flexion you want. So high amount of bone will be removed. So you have to balance accordingly in the implant. Then another thing, the tibial component. So in the tibial component, I just told you that you can have symmetric tray and asymmetric tray. So as I told you, that if you see the medial femoral condyle, it is longer like this, as compared to the lateral femoral condyle. So I hope you can see it clearly here. Look at this anterior posterior length of the medial tibial condyle, much longer. So the medial femoral condyle can roll front and back, where the lateral remains fixed, and that is a medial pivot. Similarly, when you're choosing your tibial component, you can choose between a symmetric and an asymmetric tray. Now, what tray would be better? Here, obviously, the asymmetric tray will be better, because technically the medial side is longer than the smaller side. If you have a medial pivot knee, you will be finding asymmetric trays. But as a beginner, go with symmetric trays, because the advantage of the symmetric tray is that you can rotate it in different directions to control your patellar tracking in the initial stages. The problem will be you won't be able to give the same amount of coverage as in an asymmetric tray. But in the initial stages, not having problems is the key. So initially start using symmetric trays so that patient malalignment you can accept a little bit, but it will take. But as you become expert, try to shift towards anatomy, the asymmetric tray. Okay. Now in the tibial component, something very important is this tibial slope. Now tibial slope naturally in the knee is around 7 degrees. That gives the posterior femoral rollback. In the implant, this tibial slope is composed of two things. The first, the bony cut, jo bone ko hum kaatne wale hain. The second, the spacer has some degree of slope. Spacer mein bhi kuch slope hoti hai. So the total slope you are going to get is going to be a combination of the two in the implant. So you have to ask your implant person, what is the slope in the spacer? And now you cut the slope in the tibia accordingly, like what amount of slope you want. Most of the implants, they give 3 to 5 degrees of slope in the bone. And most of the implants leave 2 to 3 degrees of slope in the spacer. But your idea is to have 5 to 7 degrees of tibial slope to have the posterior femoral rollback. Mind you, never try to go beyond 10 or 12 degrees of slope. Why? Because sometimes you feel that higher the slope, higher the flexion. No. When you give too much of slope like this, just understand that this post will crack because there will be a posterior force on this post. So you can have fractures of the post if you go beyond a slope of 10 to 12 degrees. So ideal is to have a slope of 7-8 degrees. Try to have 3 to 5 degrees slope in the implant and 2 to 3 degrees slope in the spacer. But always ask your company person. Some companies even give 7 degrees of slope in the spacer only. Clear? So that is how decide about the tibial component. Symmetric or asymmetric design and what amount of slope you want. Femoral component, the trochlear depth that you want, how much of notch bone is being removed, that will give you the high flex knee. And in the femoral component, you have to decide about the material also, cobalt, chromium, femoral, tibial, dunamen. And in the femoral component, you have to decide about the radius of the curvature. That is different among different implants. You can choose any because no single part has been proven to be better. The single radius better, a multiple radius better. And regarding the polyethylene spacer, few important things. If you want a high flex knee, the patella can engage the spacer. So you have to have anterior beveling in the spacer so that the impingement of the patella with the spacer is not there. Okay. So that is very important regarding your polyethylene spacer. So, and yes, when you fit the components regarding the size matching, yeah, many implant companies say that match any size, set 2 ka nahi, 3 ke spacer, those kind of things. That you take 2 size femoral component fitted with a 5 size tibial component. So the idea of size matching is plus minus 1. What I mean by this plus minus 1, that if you have used a 2 size tibial component, your femoral component should be 1 or 3. If you have a 5 size femoral component, your tibial component should be 6 or 4. Means both the components should be actually 1 size up and down of each other. Although companies even allow 2 or 3 sizes to vary. कि भाई 5 के टिबियल कंपोनेंट के साथ 3 का टिबियल स्पेसर पे लगा लो, टिबियल फ्रे भी लगा लो, कंपनीज से, बट यू शुड ट्राई टू एम एट योर सर्जरी जस्ट हैव अ प्लस 1 साइज अप डाउन इन द 2 कंपोनेंट्स. सो आई विल अगेन समराइज फॉर यू दैट इन केस यू आर लुकिंग फॉर अ हाई फ्लेक्स नी अमंगस्ट ऑल द वैरायटीज डिफरेंट कंपनीज, बिकॉज़ डिफरेंट कंपनीज समथिंग सम कंपनी वुड हैव वन फैक्टर, सम वुड हैव द अदर फैक्टर. सो व्हाट फैक्टर्स वुड गिव यू द बेस्ट रेंज ऑफ नी मूवमेंट इन द इम्प्लांट? Because implant is a big determinant of knee range of motion. First thing regarding radius of curvature, you can choose either the single or the multiple radius, either. Don't go after the company that if my single radius is there, this will be the best. Because I've told you the advantage with a single radius more offset, but advantage with this multiple radius is less tension in the collaterals. So both give same flexion. So both give that recommended same flexion. The spacer has to be beveled anteriorly. The trochlear notch has to be deep. The slope has to be around 7 degrees combined slope. Okay. So you have to have a mechanism for posterior femoral rollback, cam post. And if it's not deep dish, that dish in the spacer, or you have to retain the PC. So are you clear with components of a high flex knee? Yes, guys. Or is there a query on it? So you can just raise your thumb if you're clear with the things that you need to check for when you're ordering a high flex knee. Yes? Any query on it? So I hope you're clear with all these factors. So these are the things you will find the company people telling you. So you should know the truth when to order what. Perfect. Enough. So no queries. So now I think I can just quickly move with this surgical technique also. So I'll just go step by step. Okay. First of all, the approaches. So we go from the front of the knee. The incision can be midline or on either sides. Midline is the preferred incision. If you have to prefer anything other than midline, then your incision can be slightly medial to midline. This is acceptable, but not a lateral incision. Now, once you go in, the classical approach is a medial parapatellar approach. Okay. So I am going along the quadriceps tendon. Please leave a cuff of tissue attached here superiorly for resuturing. So cut through the tendon, not through the muscle tendon junction. Now this is the vastus medialis muscle. If you want to, don't want to disrupt the extensor mechanism, you can lift up the vastus medialis from the intermuscular septum and you can retract this whole thing laterally. This will be called the